Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. And the first portfolio is net zero, energy and transport. Usual plea that if members wishing to ask a supplementary could press the request to speak buttons. June, relevant question. That would be very helpful. Question one has been withdrawn. Question two, Patrick Harvey.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce energy consumption from the built environment.
Minister Alistair Allan.
Heating our homes and workplaces causes 20% of our emissions. We have already made significant progress. Emissions from buildings have fallen by 32% between 1990 and 2022. The energy efficiency of our homes is increasing across all tenures, and more heat pumps are being installed than ever before. Over 150,000 households in Scotland have already benefited from our delivery schemes, and we provided over £210 million to these schemes in the last financial year. We intend to lay regulations in December 2024 to deliver a Scottish equivalent to the Passive House standard.
Patrick Harvey.
The Minister is quite right about the critical aspect of the Heat in Buildings programme as part of the transition to a net zero society. And over the last few years, the Scottish Government has developed a programme that's been well regarded and even described as what could be a template for action across the rest of the UK. But in the last few weeks, I've been hearing increasing rumours of large-scale job losses in Home Energy Scotland, and even one suggestion that the entire grant and loan scheme is going to be put on hold. Will the Minister take this opportunity to scotch those rumours, make it clear that those changes will not happen, and if there is any danger of changes like that taking place, will he immediately begin a discussion with Exchequer colleagues to ensure that the additional money that's now available to the Scottish Government following yesterday's UK budget is made available to reverse any changes that have been suggested so far?
Minister.
Well, obviously, the Scottish Government will have to study what the UK Government's budgets, their implication is for Scotland. We do work with suppliers and others to try to make sure there is as much certainty as possible in these matters. But we are obviously at the mercy of decisions in the UK about what our overall budget is. But we certainly do keep in touch with suppliers and with agencies to try to make sure that there is as much certainty in the system as we can.
Question three, Mark Ruskell.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is supporting local transport authorities to franchise bus services.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has delivered all the bus powers within the Transport Scotland Act 2019 to enable local transport authorities to consider all of the powers available to them, including franchising, and will provide general and statutory guidance on the franchising process. This is currently under development and will be published once the remaining franchising legislation is completed. It's for local transport authorities to determine what powers, if any, to use to improve local bus services. Any authority considering the franchising powers must ensure their business case is made robustly and in an evidence-based way to support future decisions.
Mark Ruskell.
It should be quite clear to the Minister, following last night's vote, that he does not have the confidence of this Parliament or stakeholders in the franchising process for Scotland's bus services. So can I ask him how he will rebuild that confidence in the months ahead? Because the first decision on franchising is unlikely to take place until summer 2027, so there is time to work constructively with SPT and other transport authorities on a fairer and more robust process, which actually puts the public interest at the heart.
Minister.
Well, I'd beg to differ with Mark Ruskell's assessment of that. And I'm struggling to understand how he says that yesterday there was no agreement on franchising. And every discussion I've had, every debate I've had, everybody talks about how they want franchising to happen. These regulations were set in 2019 primary legislation. I get the fact that there has been some issues over the last week in response to that. I have contacted my officials to say that I will continue to have conversations with Valerie Davison and Stephen Donovan from SPT, but it's to give the surety to the people who are demanding franchising takes place that the process stays on course.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Colin Beattie.
The Transport Act 2019 enabled franchising, and the SNP has made significant improvements to public transport in Scotland, including free bus fares for our young people. Can you say anything Can the Minister say anything more about the impact of these policies on the affordability and accessibility of public transport and vision for improvement going forwards?
Slightly wide of the original question, but if there's anything you can add, Minister, briefly.
Okay. The free bus to travel is opening up opportunities all over the country for children and families, for young people, and it is literally enabling young people to broaden their horizons to choose to study further away from home where that suits. Franchising would be part of that process, and we aim to continue to move that forward.
Thank you. And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Jonathan Bray, one of the leading experts in bus franchising development across the UK, has said that if Scotland adopts the panel-based approach by giving unilateral power to the Transport Commissioner to veto SPT's plans for a bus franchise, potentially, it will be a serious mistake which will ultimately be seen as such. It's hard to see any rational justification for it other than it serves the interests of those who wish to maintain the status quo for as long as possible, that the panel should be deleted from the process and that the Regional Transport Authority, SPT, should be given unfettered ability democratically to implement the desired scheme for the region. And that has the support of Parliament, both in committee and, I would contend, in this chamber. Would the Minister agree to revise the proposal to have those powers vested in the Transport Commissioner and come back to this place with a revised scheme and amend the legislation accordingly?
Minister.
The SPT actually agree that checks and balances should be in place, which is why it was put in the 2019 Act. So the process that has gone through, we are at the position just now where the panel will be put in place. It will have the full scrutiny. We'll put the guidance in place that the committee will then get a chance to look at. And we are on the process. If we delay it, we go back to primary legislation, as I've already said, in the number of debates, we go back to primary legislation and we stall it even further. As I've said, I'm preparing to meet with SPT and we will discuss this further, but franchising is moving at the right pace and going forward.
Thank you. Question 4, Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government if it is committed to fully duelling the A96 from Inverness to Aberdeen.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government remains absolutely committed to improving the A96. In particular, we have recently completed the statutory process for duelling between Inverness and Nairn, including the Nairn bypass, along with the adjacent inches to Smithton scheme. We are now pressing ahead with the procedural steps to complete the purchase of land. The current plan is to fully duel the route, and as part of this process, we are undertaking a transparent, evidence-based review of the programme, which includes a climate compatibility assessment and other statutory assessments. Once published, this review will be subject to public consultation.
Douglas Ross.
I'm sorry, the Cabinet Secretary just doesn't get it from that answer. She said the Government are committed to improving the A96, but the pledge that she and her colleagues were elected on in 2021 was to fully duel the A96 from Inverness to Aberdeen. And communities in Moray, across the Highlands and the North East are looking today for that commitment to be reaffirmed by the Transport Secretary. In their manifesto, they said at page 72, this was required, the duelling of the A96, to ensure that the road network between all Scottish cities is of dual carriageway standard. Does the Cabinet Secretary still stand by that? And if not, why does she not prioritise businesses and people in the North East of Scotland as much as other parts of the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Douglas Ross says he's sorry. I'm sorry that he didn't listen to my answer. And Presiding Officer, can I particularly draw the attention to my first answer, where I said, in particular, we've recently completed the statutory process for duelling between Inverness and Nairn, including the Nairn bypass, along with the adjacent inches to Smithton scheme. We are now pressing ahead with the procedural steps to complete the purchase of land. The current plan is to fully duel the route as part of this process, etc. We are undertaking the transparent review. Presiding Officer, I think it wastes time of this Parliament if members don't listen to the original answer and then have to repeat and get the same answer to the first question.
Point of order, Douglas Ross.
Point of order. I know we can't rehash the debate, but can the Chair confirm that the Cabinet Secretary's initial answer was the Scottish Government is committed to improving the A96, not to fully duelling? That's what her answer was.
Mr Ross, you will know that it's not a matter for the Chair to determine the responses, nor indeed the supplementary questions. I'm going to take a supplementary from Karen Adam.
Thank you, President. Excuse me. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since 2007, there have been significant improvements made to road infrastructure in the North East, and upgrades to the A96 are an important next step. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out examples how the Scottish Government investment has improved connectivity across the North East?
Cabinet Secretary.
North East demands and deserves good connectivity. That's why this government has spent more than £1 billion on road infrastructure in the North East since 2002. We've also opened two new railway stations. But if you're looking at the opening of the projects such as the A96 Fockabers and Mosthodlock bypass, the A96 Inveramsey bridge improvement, and of course it was this government that continued to benefit the North East by the completion of the AWPR. That's reduced journey times, it's improved journey time reliability for those travelling around the city of Aberdeen. And additionally, the Hodgson Improvement Project is improving traffic flow. These are all investments by this government in the northeast of Scotland.
Question 5, Tim Eagle.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to improve public consultation on renewable energy projects by energy companies.
Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is currently developing pre-application guidance for overhead transmission line projects, which will outline the clear and meaningful opportunities we expect for the affected communities to be consulted fully on the route and design of overhead electricity lines. We've also worked closely with the UK Government on a consultation aimed at modernising the overall Scottish energy consenting scheme by proposing updates to the reserve legislation which underpins our decision making. The consultation launched this week and includes proposed legislative changes to mandate pre-application consultation for large-scale projects.
Tim Eagle.
Thank you very much. Can I quickly just refer members to my register of interest as a former land agent who advised clients on renewable issues? During Tess White's debate earlier on, you asked me if I would help support you. The Acting Cabinet Secretary, Presiding Officer, asked me if I would help support her calls for making mandatory consultation and engagement with the public by transmission operators, which I agree with. That's fine. Because communities are hurting across the Highlands and Islands and across Scotland with the amount of infrastructure that is going on. However, it was recently announced that the UK and Scottish Government have launched a joint consultation to change the planning process for large energy projects, which could see Council's automatic right to a public inquiry removed. That's going to hurt public in places across Scotland. Will the Cabinet Secretary guarantee that Council's right to review of such projects will be protected? Please don't tell me Labour and the SNP are planning to stitch up communities more.
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I think that Tim Eagle will not be surprised to hear that the way that he has characterised these reforms are not in line with what my vision is for this. I want enhanced opportunities for communities to be involved in the earliest stage in the consultation. We're also producing, we're actually not waiting for this consultation to actually go through the UK government as well. We're actually bringing proposed guidance for community consultation. But there should be, I believe, and I have always believed, that the consultation should be mandatory and have guidance associated with it, because I agree with Tim Eagle that communities deserve and should have meaningful opportunities to engage with developers well before the application goes in.
Supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The ability to make pre-application community engagement mandatory is reserved to the UK Government under the consenting regime of the UK Electricity Act 1989, limiting our ability to reform energy policy. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what engagement the Scottish Government has had with the new UK Government on reforms to ensure that process can be taken forward swiftly while giving communities a voice?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Bill Kidd for that question. That gives me an opportunity to say that I have had multiple meetings with the new UK government ministers on this point. Indeed, in my first meetings with Michael Shanks and Ed Miliband, I actually raised this point because we did not have agreement on moving this forward with the former UK government on the mandating of community benefits and engagement. So I'm pleased to say that this consultation is a result of that sort of lobbying that I've done in those conversations that I've had. We launched this joint consultation that can specifically address the issues raised. I greatly appreciate the level of engagement and collaboration shown by the current UK government as we've collectively worked through the detail of these proposed reforms, which are reflective of a lot of the public the public's discontent with the current system that Bill Kidd has just articulated.
Thank you. Question 6, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to fully implement the recommendations of the second Strategic Transport Projects Review in relation to the A77.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hyslop.
We value the critical link that the A77 provides, in particular the connectivity with the ports at Kinraran to the wider trunk road network. Our investment in the Maybole bypass, opened in January 2022, is a clear statement of that commitment. Recommendation 40 is in development and follows on from the robust strategic case for investment made in STBR2. This is a long-term plan, and we must not forget the continued investment we make in the maintaining and safe operation of that route.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. 2 years after the final plan was published, there's still no clear implementation plan or timescale for these commitments, and that's deeply disappointing. But will the Cabinet Secretary consider the deep concerns over what impact of what appears to be a growing use of full road closures of the A77 and indeed the impact of closures on the A77 of the A75 when routine maintenance is being carried out and which often leads to detours of hours for drivers? Will she consider the request from the A77 Action Group for a task force bringing together local stakeholders with Transport Scotland and AMI Highways to explore what more we can do to minimise that disruption for residents, local businesses and users of that road?
Cabinet Secretary.
So clearly in terms of improvements for the road, which are essential, and also for road safety, there has to be measures to improve the road. In terms of being able to do that without full closure of the road, that is obviously an operational matter for the roads operator. But I do hear what the member says. I think it was difficult to follow which road closures he was referring to. I know there are current concerns about the A75, but his original question was about the A77. I had intended to meet those in the A75 area, but the First Minister has now agreed to visit. So in the meantime, I have approached the A77 campaign group in the meantime to talk to them, and that may be an issue that I can raise with them in terms of the impact of that. And I'll also try and identify if with the operator, have they considered alternatives. But we've got to be realistic. If we want to improve roads for road safety and for other measures, we do have to make sure that that work is carried out. And that may mean, in some circumstances, full closures and diversions, particularly for HGVs. And as I mentioned, the connectivity with Kinraran is obviously a very important part of that road network.
And supplementary, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The A77 is a key trunk road, both for those who live close to it and for those further afield. Thousands stand to benefit both in quality of life and in boosted economic activity from further improvements. With that in mind, can I ask again, what major improvements does the Scottish Government have planned for the A77 in the next decade?
Cabinet Secretary.
So in terms of the activity, she'll know there has been substantial investment already. She knows that from the Maybole bypass. In addition, there were additional £35 million improvements in other areas in relation to Clenap, Hagston and other areas. In terms of going ahead, there are resurfacing schemes recently completed at Ballantrae and south of Girvan. Resurfacing schemes are planned on the A77 air bypass roundabouts, Bankfield, Holmston, Whitlets in this financial year.
Thank you. Question 7, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support the internal ferry fleet in Orkney.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since 2018-19, the Scottish Government has provided Orkney Islands Council with £87.7 million worth of support in the operation of its internal ferry fleet. We also recognise the fleet replacement challenge facing the Council, and in that regard, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and I met with the Council at the Orkney Ferry Replacement Task Force earlier this month. We were pleased to be able to confirm the allocation of £3 million additional funding to support the Council's electric ferry trial, design work for the North Isles Ferry and the desktop-based work on the proposed port upgrades.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The news that the Scottish Government is investing £3 million into Orkney's internal ferry fleet will be really positive for Orkadians who rely on these services to travel for various professional, educational and social opportunities. Can the Minister outline how the Scottish Government will continue to work in partnership with the Orkney Islands Council to ensure that decisions around improvements to local transport links are made in consultation with local communities and with the best interests of islanders at its core?
Minister.
Yeah, Ms Roddick highlights a really important issue, and it has been made clear to me in the meetings and visits with the islanders that transport links are key to economic and social well-being, especially for island residents, communities and businesses, so they must be involved in the decisions that are affecting these services. In light of that, the importance of hearing the voice of communities is a key theme in our island's connectivity plan. From meetings of the task force, it's clear that Orkney Islands Council is focused on meeting the needs of its island communities, and we remain committed to supporting the Council with this work, including as it progresses its business cases.
Thank you. Question number 8, James Dornan, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many journeys in Glasgow have been taken by under-22s using a free bus pass in the last year.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the 12 months up to the 30th of September 2024, there were 10,657,077 bus journeys made by children and young people for free using a card issued within the Glasgow City Region deal.
James Dornan.
I thank the Minister for that very positive response. Does he agree with me this scheme has been clearly hugely successful in making bus travel more attractive to people at a younger age and has the accumulated benefit of opening up social, education, employment and leisure opportunities that younger people may not have access to?
Minister.
Yeah, I completely agree with the points that James Donner is making. This is a truly transformational policy and it is opening up opportunities to young people right across Scotland in leisure, learning, work and social activities, family connections, and that would not otherwise be available to them. There have been over 170 million free bus journeys made under the Young Person Scheme since January 2022 and over 772,000 cardholders have now signed up. This landmark policy is helping young people and families with children cut costs every day and with leisure and travel, while at the same time helping to protect our climate.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on net zero energy and transport. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.